Their music reaches us before anything we could imagine of. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you all to just mark your presence with a round of applause for making it from a busy schedule. I want everyone present here to give himself or herself a round of applause, because in today's busy world, I'm sure even if we bet on anything in life, we would not be able to take out a single minute for any other thing than ourselves. So here we are at the inaugural function of Brahma Research Foundation. I welcome each and every dignitary who has noted this event as a priority and made it to help this evening become successful. It's not always about your schedule, it's only giving preferences to your priorities. And when it comes to our nation, India, the security of our nation is of utmost importance. Again, I want everyone to give a round of applause as a salute to all the martyrs that have laid down their lives in securing India as a nation. I welcome with a very warm heart Colonel Venkatraman, honorary speakers Sri D. Sivanandan, Dr. Prabhakaran Paleri, Sri V. Balachandran, and our lovely and homely Dr. Vijay Page. So now, the dignitaries have made it. It is a time that we welcome them once again, ladies and gentlemen. I would like Dr. Vijay Page to escort the dignitaries on the dais. As we know, the date from the year it happened is written in dark black. A day everyone in India, especially in Mumbai, wants to forget. But it keeps recurring every year. It keeps on haunting and hurting our hearts, our souls, that we have lives that were lost on that very night. Few of our daring officers, while pursuing their duties, laid down to the nation. And in that course, I request everyone to spare a moment and pay homage to everybody who have now been a soul of the 26/11 attack. Here we are presenting Om Shanti. And now, I request everyone to stay at the AV, please. That's a salute to the officers who were brave enough to save our city. So now, as we are in Maharashtra and in India, that we follow a varied heritage, so I request all the dignitaries to please light the lamps and start this evening with warmth.
वेद प्रतिपाद्या जय जय स्वसंवेद्या आत्मरूपा देवा तुचि गणेशु सकलमति प्रकाशु मणि निवृत्ति दासु अवधारी जो जी ओम या कुंदेन्दु तुषार हार धवला या शुभ्र वस्त्रावृता या वीणावर दंड मंडित करा या श्वेत पद्मासना या ब्रह्माच्युत शंकर प्रभृति निशेष जाड्यापहा।
असतो मा सदगमय, तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय, मृत्युर मा अमृतगमय। दिस द लाइटिंग ऑफ लैम्प्स एम्बार्क्स एनलाइटमेंट। इट्स फ्रॉम द डार्कनेस टू द प्रोग्रेस दैट वी परसीव आवर जर्नी। And now, I would like to call upon our very own and homely, a fatherly figure who has over 4 decades of rich experience as a senior government official, management consultant, academician, and strategic affairs thinker. He has served as the CMD of Konkan Development Corporation, Director PMO, National Oil Palm Mission, a member of the UN Global Compact, Maharashtra Planning Commission, Mumbai University, and a consultant to USAID, World Bank, and similar other functions. Let's welcome, with a round of applause, Mr. Dr. Vijay Page for the welcome speech.
Distinguished dignitaries on the dais, the Honorable Legislature of Bandra Constituency, Sri Ashish Shelarji, veteran of Mount Everest Expedition, Commander Kannan, former Secretary Government of Government of India Shipping Transport, Joseph Sir, President of All India Management Association, Dr. Ajit Singh and his colleague Patil Sir. I'm honored to find the hall drawn to attention and rapt attention on this occasion. Brahma Research Foundation is a small effort by intellectuals, professionals, academicians, and committed social workers. The purpose is focusing on public policy and strategic issues pertaining to India nationally and internationally. We are building a platform which will be independent, private, non-partisan, non-profit research organization whose main goal will be to influence popular policy, policy making and implementation. Over the 8 decades of post-independence, state and private sector institutions have worked hard to build structures and policy frameworks of which all of us are very proud of. And yet we find there are many gaps and slippages in the last mile delivery. The attempt at BRF is to holistically study such beneficiaries, such policy frameworks, and through technology intervention and dialogues with subject experts as well as beneficiaries, improve the efficacy of the delivery system. At the same time, BRF will try to analyze and attempt alternate global theater assessment scenarios to meet current and future threats to our country. Areas of conflict like the Indo-Pacific, Quad 1, Quad 2, these frameworks will require closer scrutiny and wider debate to assess and project strategic threats in the global socio-political theater, which the BRF will try to coordinate and coordinationally analyze for mutual benefit. Today, we have chosen to present the current and future threats against the backdrop of hostile neighbors and the likely interventions of high-tech terrorism tools. With the advancement of security hardware and software technology deployment and adoption of government initiatives like the Atmanirbhar Bharat, it is critical to ensure that the mainstream society is engaged in a participatory fashion so that we cause to achieve a safer and peaceful future. The monograph presented today has attempted to put the traditional as well as high-tech threats in national perspective so that we remain alert at all levels of the society and achieve Atmanirbhar Bharat se hi Atmanirbhay Bharat. To this end, I wish to remind the distinguished gathering of the clarion call given by Swami Vivekananda at the beginning of the 20th century. When he was meditating atop the rock at Kanyakumari, he came out and said, Uttishta Jagrita Prapyavaran Bodhita. Arise, awake, stop not till the goal is reached. To this end, BRF will strive to work, get the intellectuals and professionals like the distinguished gathering here together to analyze and chalk out the way forward for mutual benefit and peace. Thank you very much, sir.
I hereby request Dr. Vijay Pagi to felicitate our respected and honorary dignitaries. Requesting Dr. Pagi to please welcome Sri V. Balachandran. Here we are, as a memento, the best of Lata. Followed by the felicitation of Dr. Prabhakaran Paleri. Now to felicitate Shri D. Sivanandan. And last but not the least, Colonel Venkat Raman. A brief about Colonel Venkat Raman. A retired colonel with 25 years of service in the Indian Army as an officer in the Corps of Engineers, Colonel Venkat Raman has served in various positions, technical, supervisory, and managerial. A well-educated and talented personality with a high degree of administrative, analytical, and technical knowledge, as well as excellent communication skills, who has the ability to lead and administer efficiently almost any team to perfection. Having a master's in business administration from Anna University, Chennai in 2001, he went on to get a master's degree in psychology from the University of Madras, ICE, in 1998. Colonel Raman was also awarded the Army Commander Eastern Command Commendation Card in 1983 for exemplary service beyond the call of duty while constructing fortifications in high altitude areas in Sikkim while on active service. He has also written several articles for technical journals like Indian Road Congress Seminar Proceedings in 1996, Institution of Engineers Seminar Proceedings 1998, and Indian Road Congress Seminar Proceedings in 2003 on civil engineering subjects. I hereby, after a brief intro to Dr. Colonel Venkat Raman, now we have the release of the BRF monograph and website launch. This is the moment, ladies and gentlemen, we witness and record in the history. Whilst we release the BRF monograph, something more about the Brahma Research Foundation. Brahma Research Foundation is a new strategic research think tank based in Mumbai, focusing on public policy and strategic issues impacting India nationally and internationally. And now, on the big screen, we witness the launch of the website. I request Shri V. Balachandran to please launch our website. I hereby request retired Colonel Shri Venkat Raman sir to please highlight the BRF monograph.
Good evening, everyone. Okay, so at the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Page and all the eminent people here on the dais for having given me this wonderful opportunity to address the gathering as the first one of today's proceedings. What I am going to present before you quickly are ideally a talk on what actually happened on 26/11 and the findings of the Pradhan Committee report. So as a prelude to that, let me quickly start about what actually happened. The Mumbai attacks, as you can see, occurred on this day in 2008, and they were a series of terrorist attacks that took place when 10 members of the Lashkar-e-Taiba of Pakistan, a terrorist organization, carried out 12 coordinated shooting and bombing attacks in 4 days in Mumbai. So, 8 of these attacks occurred in South Mumbai at Chhatrapati Shivaji Terminus, the longest one at Trident, Taj Palace, Leopold Cafe, Kama Hospital, Nariman House, Metro Cinema, in a lane behind the Times of India building, and the St. Xavier's College, as you saw in the video as well. And by the early morning of 28 November, all the sites except for Taj Hotel had been secured by the Mumbai police and the security forces. On 29th November, India's National Security Guards, NSG, conducted Operation Black Tornado to flush out the remaining terrorists. And it came to an end, finally. So 30th of December, the Maharashtra government appointed a 2-member high-level inquiry committee, one of whom is sitting here in our presence, the chief guest today. Of Pradhan Committee, that is the Inquiry Commission, the ex-Home Secretary and Shri Balchandran IAS were part of that panel. They probed the security forces' response to the 26/11 Mumbai terror attacks. And the committee comprised of the former Home Secretary and former IPS officer, V. Balachandran. So the committee was tasked to determine what lapses there may have been on the part of the security forces so that future attacks could be prevented, and the committee submitted its report to the Maharashtra Chief Minister in April 2009. Now, what did it really find? The committee found instances of lack of intelligent appreciation of threats, handling of intelligence, maintaining high degree of efficiency in instruments specially set up to deal with the attacks, overt and visible leadership in carrying out operations to face multi-targeted attacks. What were the key findings? Lack of intelligence, lack of a nodal officer, lack of protective clothing and equipment, inadequate training, lack of leadership, poor tactics, and lack of flow of information. Well, we can say in hindsight that maybe we were not prepared for an attack of this magnitude, and certainly we must keep that in mind for future. A few more findings. Lack of training and casual response, the performance of QRT teams below par. The QRT stands for quick response teams. Lack of centralized command center, collaboration between civil and police authorities was found wanting. Joint action with coast guards also was not very evident. And then shortage of ammunition and equipment. Some action areas. Continual awareness and sensitizing public on the threat perception to the city and soft targets in particular. This is because people have a tendency to forget and get lulled. We unfortunately forget bad things very quickly and we move on. Especially the city of Mumbai has a tendency to move on because life must go on. But then we need to learn our lessons and ensure that they are not repeated. Improved coordination between the police, civil administration, and security forces when called out, command center to be created, and situation to be monitored by a high-ranking officer. There has to be a central command leadership so that there is no confusion. Then intelligence needs to be kept at very high level. At all times, agencies need to be alert 24/7 so as to thwart ingress of any anti-national elements into the city and their environs. The very fact that they came in a dinghy from South Mumbai, and nobody even knew that they were coming is from Machimar Nagar, shows that we were simply not aware enough for this threat, or we did not take enough precautions. Then flow of information to be continuous and clear for smooth conduct of operations, continuous training of police and security forces, special QRT teams to be kept earmarked. In fact, all this will now be further shown in the next talk. Procurement of weapons and equipment should not have any bottlenecks, as they are vital for security of our country. Media should not be allowed to be involved too much into conduct of operations, as it may result in intelligence falling into the hands of the enemy and also might create panic. You know, those were the days of live television, Sansani Khez Khabar, and we could see for 3 days everything happening in front of us. Especially started with CST and then it went on to Taj. Taj, it happened for 3 days. And ideally, while we all love a lot of sensationalism, we must understand that everyone in the world is seeing it. And it becomes a security threat. So, here I end my talk, and I would now like to hand over to the next speaker, Mr. D. Shivanandan, IPS, who will tell you all what all has been done.
I will introduce myself, sir. Can you give me the remote?
Yes.
The wireless. We can bring it to that level, to my... Can you put it down? Mine is different.
Second one.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, all the dignitaries on the dais, Mr. Balachandran and Mr. Page and various other dignitaries sitting right in front of me. Very good evening to everyone. At the outset, I would like to congratulate Mr. Page and his team for having launched a think tank, a much needed think tank in Mumbai. That is the Brahma Research Foundation. And I wish them luck, and I wish them a fantastic way ahead so that we can all learn and we can improve. I brought a presentation, and they are loading it. Until then, I thought I'll speak for a while. But I would like to, it's getting loaded. Is this one? Then give me the remote. So I would like to say that I got a lot of slides, so I will be going a little faster than necessary. Second is, I'm going to speak about what the government of Maharashtra did after appointing the RD Pradhan Commission. And then later, which one to press? This one. Okay. So then I was the commissioner of police after the attack. And maybe after 5-6 months after the attack, then I was in charge of making the city safe. So this is what happened that time. All the credit to government of Maharashtra. One rider is that this is what happened at that time. Now it is about 11, 12 years. So things should have gone much ahead of it. So I'm not attempting to tell you what is the ground situation today, because I'm not privy to what all happened after that. This is in 2010-11. So after that, what all happened, the Coast Guard people can say, the Navy can say, the police officers can say, and all others can say. I'm only trying to show you what was the response of the government of Maharashtra, all credit to them, as per the guidance given by the RD Pradhan Committee. So this is the place. You saw the video, and later Colonel Venkatraman also showed you some idea about all that. They had chosen only a radius of 1 or 2 kilometers only. One bomb went off near Villeparle, that is a taxi by mistake. So this is that area, small, short area. They could take cabs and go from place. This is the route to Mumbai. Not that they just landed there in the Machimar Nagar in Cuff Parade or anything like that. They came from Pakistan, a place called Murdike, and then they came to Gujarat. Then they took, that boat was Al Husseini, and then the Kuber, and then from there they came to 4 nautical miles away from Mumbai. They used a rubber boat and they deflated it, and they came to near President Hotel, and they marched ahead. I forgot to start my time stopwatch. Here it is. This is the route. So they have taken enough time. They have been trained well. 400 youngsters were trained, and only 10 of them had come. What happened to the others? One can always guess. So this is the details. Since 15 minutes are there, I'll just rush through. As I said, this is the landing. This is the boat which came there. And they came to CST, Kama Hospital. Kama Hospital is the place where actually a lot of action took place. Mr. Sadanand Date had gone there and fought it out with them. He lost two men. He also got a lot of shrapnel in his body. Even now it is there. And then to rescue him, the people, Mr. Karkare and various others, went there. And then what happened is known to you. This is the Chhatrapati Shivaji terminus. And in all, 166 people lost their lives. And this is the Kama to Metro. They used the police vehicle and went there. And this is the details of the people who have done. This is the Metro Junction. And this is the place where Omle, our Havaldar, took all the bullets in his body and stopped. And Iqbal, the other terrorist, was shot. And this fellow, Kasab, was arrested alive. Perhaps this is the first time it happened in the recent history. Now, all the visuals are showing this. Someone said why the press should not have. The Adi Pradhan committee had said the press should have been kept alive. The commissioner of police could have used 144 and prevented the press and kept them away 5 kilometers. But that was part of the SOP, which I happened to write later. So any such incident happening, the press would always be kept 5 kilometers away, and an additional commissioner could go and give them all the visuals or brief them periodically. All that could be done. But luckily, touch wood, nothing happened after that in Mumbai, even though in Pathankot and other places. These are the visuals. You have seen them in all this Google search, you will get all of them. But still, however, I wanted to just refresh your memory as to what all happened in those 3-4 days in Taj. This is the owner of Taj. And this is how it was. These are all their bombs. And this is the time when NSG was there. And the chief of NSG, also a senior IPS officer, he has passed away last year with COVID. He worked with me in the CBI. We were colleagues and friends. This is that old heritage Taj. 500 to 600 crores is the loss. And this is at Nariman House, where on the last day morning, thanks to TV channels who were alive and active, informed, the guy who was there in Karachi in the control room to control these people and motivate them is a boy from Bid Jilla called Abu Jundal. And so he was motivating them how to pull down the curtains in Oberoi, that Kandahar place, and how to kill people, whom to release, whom to spare, and all that. That all happened because they were to be motivated. None of them had any. This is the NSG Havildar, Gajendra Singh. When he was rappelling down, the rabbi and his wife and the child were there. And these fellows, the terrorists who were there, they were woken up. Because the control room in Karachi called, looking at the monitoring the video, I mean, the not video, the NDTV and the other channels, and that is how he was killed. This is our Major Unnikrishnan. That incident happened inside the Taj, near the old Taj. So this is how action took place, and this is the child. For looking after this child, the nanny was taken to Israel, and she was given the highest civilian award. So this is Ajmal Kasab. You can see he's no bulletproof jackets, nothing. A few dry fruit packets they had. But they had enough arms and ammunition and IEDs, improvised explosive devices, and various other things. So our men were all doing all these kind of things. This is the number of people who died. And 175 in all, including the terrorists, and injured are 309. The comparable loss was 1993, 12th March 1993. 257 people were killed. At that time, that was the highest. This is little less. 857 people were injured. And again, 12 places they had those blasts in there. Daud Ibrahim was responsible for that. And in between that, another major one was the 2011, where that 12 pressure cookers were used in the first class. 200 people died in that. So this is the busy area, and this is how things moved. I'll just quickly go as much as my remote could work. These were the articles found in the Kuber, and they were all used in trial, and they were all of very Pakistani origin. That's why they have little bit. This is the engine which was recovered, purchased from Japan through various channels, and these are all the evidence collected by the Mumbai police, and they charge sheeted the case as soon as they could. This is the Yamaha, and these are the weapons they used, and they were all, everyone knew where from it came. These are the pistols they used. The origins were all well known, and FBI, four of those deputy directors had come. I had personally accompanied and showed them all this evidence and other things. That was in 1993, not now, not in 2611. But the other agencies from all foreign countries had come, and they set up their systems, and they collected enough evidence, and they went away, including FBI, Singapore, and various others. These are satellite phones they had brought, and through that they were communicating, because our phones could be tapped, and but still, these are the logs of Kuber. Kuber is the one which came from Porbandar to Mumbai. These are all the codes and how you translate that. And this is the other code words they had used. And this is the translation of that. And these are the arms and ammunition supplied to each terrorist. I told you, each guy was carrying this many arms and ammunition. These are all the transcript. The trial happened quickly, and you know what happened in 2012. The one terrorist was hung, that is Kassab. So that is the shortened of what happened. What did the government of Maharashtra do is the what I've been asked to speak. So this is it. 6 minutes I finished, 9 minutes I have to show you this. So the lack of bulletproof jacket was one reason why these 18 brave hearts, 16 policemen died. So urgently we had to buy this thing, and there was a lot of dragging for years together, even after that they could not buy the bulletproof jackets. So I requested the MCHI to give a specific variety of the bulletproof jackets. They were kind enough to give 500 of them. So all our commandos were protected. Because you all know, they all went there because of the call of duty, the valor, the commitment to the patriotic sense and all that. But 16 people died there. So the next time, they may not go rush as they did. So this had to be done, the bulletproof helmets and all that. So here, we went to Israel, the government of Maharashtra team, I was there, and we met the police commander there, and brought trainers from there in Pune. We trained all these people, 1,000 people we trained. So in five control rooms, and they're located in five different places, 100 of them were deployed during day, and 100 in the night, so that at a given time, if any attack takes place in multiple places, 500 officers and men, well trained by Israeli commandos, armed and enough ammunition. We brought 7 simulators so that running short of ammunition is not an excuse. So this is how, this well, you are protected. So I'm telling you, in the 11 years, they might have done much more than that. I'm not aware of that. So these are the combat team, 40 vehicles with 12 men, arms, ammunition, bulletproof jacket, bulletproof helmet, and all that were there. So any place, that time, the claim was, within 2 to 7 minutes, we could reach there and tackle the situation. Multiple vehicles will follow later. One such officer, a retired officer, took a girl under a gun in one of the societies. This commando van reached between 7 to 10 minutes. The deputy commissioner and others went there. They fired only one shot after breaking the door where the man was holding the child, here in Andheri, not very far from here. So only one shot was fired. The child did not even know, but they brought him down, and then the child was released. So that is the kind of practice these people had. These are 40 such vehicles, I'll show you. Bomb disposal squad was only one. Multiple crores was required for bringing all the equipment, but we brought 13 of them, 13 deputy commissioners in their office, they are there. The 5 control rooms are in the additional commissioner's office, and they could reach out. And traffic would block the traffic so that the vehicles can reach there faster in the opposite direction if there is a need. And this is NSG. They took 26 hours to come from Manesar. We have given this place at Marol, and they can go. We got a carbon copy of NSG's zonal deployment. They could be taking care of 4 states. Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, and Andhra, and things like that. So in case multiple incidents takes place, we may or may not have energy dedicated to for us, Maharashtra or Mumbai. So we have made a carbon copy of NSG. Same number of people, same weapon, same training, same toughness. It is called Force One. So that is also ready now. Energy is deployed since then. This is that vehicle I talked about, local vehicle, and so Mahindra's production, 85 lakhs each, so that repair, service, and all the vehicles are running even today. All of them are running. They're doing multiple various other duties now. So this is the marksman, and this is also bulletproof, Mahindra again. And this is the Tata's troops carrier, again completely bulletproof. And these are the other vehicles. These are about 450 buddy pairs were deployed there so that they could go. Earlier also, they had 200 commandos from 1998. Colonel Chowdhury had trained them. They had AK-47 and various other guns. But these guys could also reach his place. I told you 2 minutes to 7 minutes. These guys will be doing the 2 minutes job. So here, we went around Germany, USA, UK, wherever, Israel also. We brought all these things because earlier, before the commission, they deposed that they had only 303 and Lattes, and how can we deploy the policemen? That was the deposition. So we brought all these things. Earlier also, they were there. About quite a bit of AK-47 was there. But it's what Colonel Venkatraman showed you on the screen. You would have read. Because of that defect, those weapons were not utilized there. So these are the new acquisition that time. And this would enable people to go there and tackle anything. For the close quarter battle, this is that American sniper, 3 kilometers distance and all. But unfortunately, none of them have been deployed in the last 11, 12 years. So anybody can say that what happened to all those weapons? They are all there waiting to be used. As long as they are not being used, I think you and me are safe. So let it be there. But they are battle ready. This is a close quarter battle. It's called Uzi. And MP9 is the American name. Enough of them. I'm not giving you the numbers. Enough and more is there. And any situation, NSG would go, Force One would go, Mumbai Police would go. These are all exclusively with the Mumbai Police. They have their own set of arms and ammunition. So these are 1,000 pieces were brought here, and men are trained. This is the Force One as it was formed at that time. And we spent enough money. They looked to start with like this, but later they became much more smarter like this. They became very smart, and they could go and blow a door or a window and reach the place and take effective action. So the training was all these Israeli commandos, you can see. They had come pro bono and trained our people. And this is the quick response team, that 1,000 people I was talking about. We wrote the SOPs, including keeping the TV channels little away. These are the continuous rehearsals. This is given by MHA. 28 of them, completely bulletproof. We bought 29. Government of Maharashtra bought 29. Quite a bit of crores were spent. In all, maybe to start with, was about 213 crores in all. And then this is how the Marine Police was using. What the Coast Guard would use or what the Navy would use and all are there, they would say about that. These are all the things which are procured at that time. And then, obviously, in 10 years, they have gone. These are the critical gaps. This is the control room, as RD Pradhan Committee mentioned. We revamped by 3.65 crores. And the Nagpada Hospital also, about 3.5 crores, we revamped so that people could get. We brought a psychiatrist also, Yusuf Machiswala, so that all of them could be counseled. So fitness was to be paid attention to. We checked 43,000 people free of cost. Government didn't pay for this. We arranged it. And we brought that book written by Sanjay Wok. He's the COVID committee chief, KEM dean. We gave it to the policemen so that they can eat well, eat healthy, and remain healthy. So these are 1 crore worth donated, I mean, the sense given as a gift by people like you. Three of them, 3 crores, one in Naigaon, one in Worli, one in Kalina. 3 into 3 crores. The other one in the police station, about 30 of them, are worth 25 lakhs each. So this is that Worli thing, all donated by the people. Government didn't spend money because this is that police station one. All in the, Dharavi has an air-conditioned gym. They're all working. I keep going and checking once in a way. If I travel there, I visit and have a look. And this is that for good food, good food in the sense is not bhaji and kanda bhaji and all that. They are given proper healthy meal so that they can go for Ganapati or any other deployment. 85 lakhs we spent for upgrading this. For the senior citizens, we launched a website. This is a kind of a mini bank they have that was in a dilapidated place. We made it modern like this. And we brought a training center so that continuous training is possible. Again, not from the government, our own resources, thanks to people like you. This is that connectivity with the policemen. Every month we'll print this and tell them that what do we expect from them? Samvad is discussion. So all policemen would get. This is the one, a private enterprise. We encouraged, we launched it. And then we did five programs where 1,200 people used to come, citizens used to come in five different places in the city, two in NCP and others. Dr. Abdul Kalam had come, Mr. Julio Ribeiro, KPS Gill, and various others. 20 of them had, MK Narayanan, so many of them had come and they had spoken about it so that the people will get the confidence, the policemen will get the confidence that the government is there and they will take care. So these are those magazines. This is that memorial. Built by a private person from Bandra, a personal friend of mine. But this was there in Marine Drive, near that fishery aquarium, Marine Drive. But because of the coastal road expansion last year, they shifted to the police commissioner's compound. It is like this only, designed by a private person. So even when foreigners came, like David Cameron or Carla Bruni and the president of France, when they all came, they used to come here and lay the wreaths. So this is again to remember them. Every 26-11 morning we used to have a parade and all the Matias families were brought and they were honored and all that. This is the Mumbai Roti Bank which I run. I'll take only one. So in this pandemic time, we have given 75 lakh meals. So with that, I would just conclude. My time is 16 minutes, 42 seconds. I've taken 1 minute and 42 seconds. Thank you so much for listening to me. Thank you.
If this was the case, we would have not put on the watch in the first place. Thank you, Shivanandan, sir. And now, by your speech, we all know why you are that famous amongst everybody here. So one more round of applause, please, for Shivananda, sir. And now, let me call upon to address the crowd, the ex-director general, Indian Coast Guard, a strategist, researcher, academician, and author with expertise in Indian, Naval, Customs, and Coast Guard services. He is emeritus faculty at Rashtriya Raksha University and plays a senior role in FINS, an integrated national security studies platform. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Prabhakaran Paleri.
Dignitaries, distinguished participants, dynamic organizers of BRF. I'm pleased to be here and address you fine people on a subject which Dr. Page has asked me to talk, that's about the Coast Guard's response and capacities to sort out problems like these which we are discussing. I'm not actually cleared by the Ministry of Defense or Coast Guard. So I'm here in my personal capacity and private capacity rather. So I do not have any deep rooted issues which the Coast Guard is facing, which perhaps their present Director General will be able to address. And I'm also not standing here because I was the Director General of the Coast Guard. I am standing here, I've agreed to Dr. Page that I would come and talk about it, only because I've been associated with this, the Indian Coast Guard, and subsequently with the World Coast Guards by sheer accident. Of course, it's not like becoming an accidental prime minister or somebody. This is a serious matter. The subject deals with coast guards, deals with the response, capacity building, and maritime challenges. Was this a maritime challenge or not? That's a different issue. And what are these maritime challenges the world is going to face? That again is a very serious matter on which I have written books, especially for the Institute of Defense Studies and Analysis, United Services Institute, National Maritime Foundation, Nanyang Technology University in Singapore, Ocean Policy Research Foundation in Japan, National Defense University in US. So there are quite a few things which I have come across, and that's what I would like to tell you with the background as the Indian Coast Guard. Actually, the government in India who created the Coast Guard didn't know about the Coast Guard, what exactly it is supposed to be. Like most of us buying the smartphones, we have to go to your granddaughters to teach you about that. That's fine if the government doesn't know. Government has the officers and men who will tell them what to do with the Coast Guard. But the problem is the public doesn't know about the Coast Guard in India and most countries. That's all fine, but the worst thing is when the Coast Guard officers themselves or the men themselves do not know what their service is and what they can do. This is a fact, not only in India, in many countries. So what I did was, I wrote a book on Coast Guard, Indian Coast Guard, and subsequently, many years later after my retirement, I wrote about the world Coast Guards. When I took up this research for the United Service Institute in Delhi under General Nambiar, it was the Ministry of External Affairs. Who is the actually ultimate umbrella organization for the Indian Coast Guard? And the Maritime Zone of India Act, 1976, also comes under the Law and Treaty Division of Ministry of External Affairs. But the service is under the Ministry of Defense, but it is not a military service. In some other countries, they are under various other ministries, like in the United States, it's under the Homeland Security, but it is a military service. So there are quite a lot of confusion. Basically, which I would like you to appreciate is that what a Coast Guard is. That's what I'm trying to tell you in this limited time which we have. So when I wrote this book, I have to get involved with a gentleman called K.F. Rustamji, Padma Vibhushan. I think the only IPS officer with Padma Vibhushan. Fantastic person. He was retired, living in Nana Chowk. And the admiral, who was the director general at that time, recommended me to meet him and get to know about all this. Khusro F. Rustamji was a very unique person who was the one who raised the border security force. He knew how to handle certain things. There are quite a lot of things to talk about him, and he told me with emotion about the Indian Coast Guard. He was retired, he was relaxing, and they just had a scotch with him, and the second peg I have to fill for him. Regularly, I used to visit him. That's where I learned what was the background of it. But here, like a film shooting, I will cut and go to another scene. That is the 1971 war. 1971 war, I was in the Navy, I was in the Western Naval Command. I was a young officer. Of course, I am young now also, I'm not bothered about it. Mr. Joseph has told me some time back. In 1971 war, it was a great war which we fought. That perhaps is the best war ever fought in the last 35,000 years since the first war was fought. What is so special about 1971 war was, it had all the flaws which a war can have. There was friendly firing, there was various other things. People died who would not have been dead. A ship sank, submarines torpedoed. Everything happened, but still I feel that is the best war ever fought in the world. But within 3 years' time, the Navy had a problem. That problem was not caused by Pakistan. That problem was caused by those who were jealous of us, who got frightened of India. I'm still studying that. That made Navy to rethink about what that they should do. And that's where they decided to have a Coast Guard, and the Coast Guard is created by the Indian Navy after that incident. That perhaps is the stem cell of Indian Coast Guard. And there came a dynamic Prime Minister, Madam Gandhi, who asked Padma Vibhushan Rustamji to create a force, another force for the sea. He did it exactly what she told him. But the problem was under which ministry it will go. The Home Ministry, in fact, Rustamji was from the Home Ministry. He was a special secretary in the Ministry of Home. But the acts which has to be enacted will have to be under the Ministry of External Affairs. And parallel to that, under international law, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea is also going on 25 years, which finally became the UNCLOS 3 in 1982. So India and other countries who ratify this particular international law will have to have forces that will carry out execution of whatever has been said in UNCLOS. So there were demands from various other areas coming to the government of India. And in the meantime, the losers of the 1971 war gathered together. When I say losers, it's not just one country. There are quite a few other countries that had interest in this war. And they decided, how do we go about India hereafter? So Bhutto started the nuclear activities. They got the support from various other countries. And what we have witnessed on 26/11, 2008, is actually the offshoot of all that. And we don't know what all things are going to happen further. This is the game of the weak. Terror is the game of the weak to overcome the stronger entity. So if we look at that, the Indian Coast Guard was born with respect to various activities. One of them was the loser's mindset that prompted us to have something to protect ourselves. So, in 1977, we had a Coast Guard with Morarji Desai inaugurated. 1978, the Act came into force. That is on 19th August 1978, yes. And 1st February 1977, we already had a Coast Guard borrowed from the Navy because Navy wanted to separate certain activities, especially law enforcement, from it so that they can focus on war fighting. And if they are focused on war fighting, they cannot be caught in other activities where they can slip. But that was the reason at that time. So this act, when it was made, I was with the customs. There was a new organization called Customs Marine Organization, again created by Madam Gandhi. And this came up during the emergency. And that was required, like how to control black money and parallel economy, etc. That also, I was there, and we had certain activities going on the west coast of India, and quite a lot of things have been done in that. And that department was supposed to come to the Coast Guard, which I was one of them, and I said that was not necessary, and I was taken into the Coast Guard, and we retained that for the customs commissionerates subsequently, which is there now all over India. But is it necessary? Yes, that particular force is necessary, because under the law of the sea, the customs have got jurisdiction within 24 nautical miles within the contiguous zone, whereas the police have to have, marine police have to be there for the coastal states and the islands, because they have to take care of the jurisdiction of the 12 nautical miles. So what is Coast Guard then? Coast Guard has got nothing to do with the coast or guarding. That is a compound word used by the first Coast Guard in the world that belonged to Sweden. Sweden was the first country in the world. That is immediately after the Westphalian Treaty, after the 30 years war between the Catholics and Protestants, where nobody won, so they concluded we'll have a different kind of system, a new kind of an order. And that's how the national sovereign states came up, what we see today, and tomorrow the whole concept can change. And Sweden had a coast guard. They called it Coast Guard because in the Baltic Sea, it's like a small little lake, so they had a coast guard, and then subsequently other countries had. Today the world has 127 coast guards. When I researched on it in 2009, and that publication is available, it is done in Tokyo in Japan, where I worked for one year for the Prime Minister of Japan. Under him, I created this World Coast Guard and Emerging Maritime Threats. That book can be downloaded from the, and I understand last month, the Japanese Coast Guard officers, a team has researched how Paleri's book looks now. So they have written a new book called Based on What I Have Done, What It Is Now, kind of a thing. And they have sent me a copy of that. That also will come free for you to download. At that time, there was 127 Coast Guards in the world. But after 2 years, the Sri Lanka also created a Coast Guard. And we, the Indian Coast Guard, helped all of them, like Malaysia, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh. In fact, I even get calls from Mexico and other countries who do not have Coast Guards to give them suggestions, but I do not know how to help them out. So he says, I have 30 seconds left. So I must tell you that the Coast Guard in India, out of the 127 Coast Guard, is the second best. It can be used for everything the government wants because the law states accordingly. But what is the use of you having a Mercedes if you don't drive it? The government is not using it. I don't say the government. In fact, government is not putting anything which it has to the maximum advantage. So the government to decide how to use the Coast Guard, how to use the Navy, how to use the forces which they have, which I do not know about the Navy or Army or anybody. But certainly, as far as the Coast Guard is concerned, I can guarantee you, ladies and gentlemen, that this is best, second best in the world. Don't ask me which is the first one, because there can be people who will complain about it. But this is the second best, and the government of India, if they want to, can really use it. And if you have any more doubts, I'm certainly available, or you can ask FINS to tell me, or the Rashtriya Raksha University in Lawad, Gujarat can also, I'm within their panel, so I keep on talking about it. Thank you very much for this short break.
I was in a spot of dilemma whether to update him on his time, but he had requested before he started speaking. So if this was a case we would like to hear the views. You just pull the pin off the watch and make the time stop, because immense knowledgeable people on the dais sharing their experiences. Now, the person next up is an internationally recognized Indian national security intelligence expert, an author of 3 books, and regular columnist in various national and international publications. Let's welcome the one whose expertise see him invited to speak regularly at various international and national fora on security and strategic geopolitical affairs, IPS ex-special secretary, cabinet secretary, Honorable Sri V. Balachandran, sir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for inviting me for this inauguration of Brahma Research Foundation. I congratulate Professor Page for starting a think tank in Mumbai. After my retirement in 1995 from Delhi, I tried my level best to start a think tank, a security think tank in Mumbai. I couldn't succeed. I couldn't enthuse the commercial companies to lend money to start a think tank. So we have our FinSDA, that is a wonderful example of community efforts of light thinking people, and they have done extremely good work. I had participated in the FINS seminars. And now, Dr. Page, I hope he brings in a fresh energy into the thinking of security studies in Mumbai. You may perhaps know that New York was a pioneer in establishing the Council on Foreign Relations. It's one of the best think tanks in the world. So, when I approached in 1995, our corporate friends, they said, look, if you are discussing only business, we will be able to give money, but not for security. But that's not the case with others. In New York, for example, every prime minister, visiting prime minister going to US, considers as an honor to address the Council on Foreign Relations. I want that to happen. Now it's 2021, and I'm 84. So I hope at least the next 10 years, one of these think tanks will rise to that position in which even foreign VIPs coming to Mumbai would address them. So that's my ambition, and I can congratulate Professor Page. Talking about 2611, I remember very fondly my chairman, Mr. Ram Pradhan. It was wonderful to work with him. I had, of course, Maharashtra State. I belonged to Maharashtra State Indian Police Service. I went to RAW in 1976. So I had briefly worked under him, very briefly, when he was Home Secretary. He's a wonderful manager, a wonderful leader. And he gave me directions. In fact, most of the report was written by me in my house. But how to go about and focus, that man had a wonderful sense of prioritize certain things. First of all, he didn't consult the Chief Minister or anybody. He said that this commission or committee would be only a departmental committee to examine the systemic mistakes of Mumbai police. Because at that time the headlines were 10 terrorists hold 45,000 men to ransom. How did it happen? And we lost all our reputation. I remember I used to know Professor Lutwak, one of the best brains in the world. a deep lover of India, writing a scathing article about India, that 10 terrorists could not be controlled by 45,000 policemen. That was our reputation. So Mr. Pradhan didn't want to waste energy of this committee to go into as a public hearing. They said, we will only examine the police officers and others and Matralaya people who are involved in controlling the or facing the terror attack. And the government had given us only 2 months to report because there was a furor in the assembly. And it's because of that that they appointed within 2 months. And then when we found that we could not even get an office accommodation for nearly a month, we asked for extension and we finished our work by day-to-day hearings. And my friend Shivanandan had appeared, he had given very valuable inputs, and so were other many officers, including Chief Secretary, Home Secretary, and others. So we could complete our work within the stipulated time, but then the general elections came, and then we could not submit our report. Finally, we submitted a report only in April. Now, I want to go back into that, how relevant was 2611. Yesterday and today, I had delivered online through Microsoft Teams two lectures to one of the biggest hotel groups in the world. They are still interested in 2611. I said, look, after so many years, 13 years, you are still interested in 2611. No, Mr. Balachandran, it is one of the most important terror attacks in the annals of terrorism, the history of terrorism. I will tell you exactly what they told me and what, of course, I have also read. Because when 2611 took place, I was in the USA. I was attending a Stimson Center. You must have heard about the Stimson Center. It's one of the pioneer security think tanks of America, named after the old Defense Secretary Henry Stimson. So at that time, I was there. And then people started calling me and knowing my presence there. And there I could see the reporting in US press. It was one of the unique things which they were expecting on US. They had intelligence that Al-Qaeda was going to mount attack on one or two seaside or water front cities in United States. So US today, I read it when I was there, saying that this the Americans considered as a dress rehearsal for a similar attack on the mainland of America, like Miami, San Francisco, New York, or whatnot, all those things. And then they went into a drive. Homeland Security had already prepared a defense plan in April of 2008. And they were keeping it ready, and they found this happening in Mumbai. So they felt that this was a dress rehearsal for a possible attack on US mainland. And then the nexus between the Lashkar-e-Taiba and Al-Qaeda had already been established by some of the American authors. There is a professor, Stephen Tankel, who is a friend of mine. He had written a wonderful book visiting the Lashkar-e-Taiba camps in Pakistan, and he is one of the world's best authorities on Lashkar-e-Taiba, and he had proved the nexus between LET and then the Al-Qaeda. So that is how it is. Now the features of 2611, which were very unique. Number one was, this is the first urban terror attack in which live control was held by a foreign group, and they were directing the terrorists in Mumbai through mobile networks. This has never happened anywhere. This is revealed by Raymond Kelly. Now, USA, when the 2611 took place, they were so alarmed that within a matter of 2611, by 9th of December, the Department of Homeland Security held a hearing, and then the New York Police Commissioner Raymond Kelly was examined, and he gave all this, you know, he saw it. And even that, before that, Mr. Mueller, who was the FBI chief, had addressed a Council on Foreign Relations about this attack and how it is significant to USA. So if this happens in the United States, if the control is in Mexico or in Canada, how would they do it? This is a new feature, totally new feature. The second important thing was deception of the mobile networks through VOIP, Voice Over Internet Protocol. And then there is a company called Calphonix. Through them, they booked bogus cell numbers indicating the origin of Austria or Russia or any other country, Ukraine, and then gave it to these terrorists. So with the effect that when our people started tapping, they found that these numbers were all coming from different things, but actually they were in Mumbai, and then they were talking to Karachi. So this was the second thing in which the subterfuge was used for hiding the identity of the terrorists. The third feature was, for the first time, domestic visual media. At that time, Ms. Barkadat came into great criticism, but actually she was only doing her job. But that provided a lot of inputs to the Pakistan handlers. And domestic visual media of the target country, that is India, provided inputs to the terrorist handlers to recalibrate that they were sent with a particular intention. But then they started recalibrating the assault techniques. And the handler from Karachi was telling, वो ऐसा सुना है एक मिनिस्टर है ताज में उनको ढूंढ रो और किल उसको मारा हो यू नो दिस टाइप ऑफ थिंग वॉज नेवर हर्ड नाउ सो द केली सेड दैट इन अ डेमोक्रेटिक कंट्री वेर देर इज अ फ्री प्रेस हाउ डू वी कंट्रोल द प्रेस हाउ डू वी कंट्रोल द विजुअल मीडिया कैन वी कॉन्ट डू दैट सो दिस इज अनदर प्रॉब्लम विच द यू एस हैंडल दैट And as I said, the terrorists took advantage of the media. Now, this the fourth important feature was this 2611 was a trendsetter to similar attacks elsewhere in the world. That is, Fidayeen attack. Till then, as Shivanandan pointed out, from 1993, we had those improvised explosive devices. At that time, what happened is that the bombs used to go off, and the police, you know, within a matter of some hours, the explosions are over. 2006 railway bombing also was like that. And all the police had to do was to go, remove the injured, help the injured, preserve the scene of crime, collect evidence, and prosecute. That is not the case here. The first time in Leopold Cafe, when they started shooting at the police, they knew that these are not drug gangs, these are not criminal gangs, these are terrorists. Now, this particular thing was never experienced. Of course, naturally in Kashmir, this was experienced. But elsewhere in the country, it was not. To a small extent, the parliament attack, it was there. But it was over within no time. And so this was a new thing which came. This, if you see the history, in 2011, in Norway, a mad right-wing person called Breivik, he opened fire on the immigrants and he killed 77. And in 2005, January, we had this Charlie Hebdo, that is a French satirical magazine. They were shot and by Cauchy brothers. In November 2015, the Islamic State had that massacre at six places in Paris, starting with Stade de France, Stadium of France, 130 deaths. Then in May 2017, there was that Ariana Grande concert in Manchester. They opened fire and 23 died. 1,017 were injured. So this became a trendsetter all over the world. So this, they say, this was based on the modus operandi of the 2611. That is why 2611 still interests people. That is why I was told to give lectures yesterday and today to a global audience of, as I said, you know. So we have to, the Maharashtra government, especially Shiva, succeeded the Commissioner of Police. He introduced very good, far-reaching changes in the capability, and he has given a small account of what he has done, but in fact, he has done much more, and this was continued. Now, this, but even in this, certain basic things we forgot. I remember in 2010, I was invited there is an annual Asia-Pacific Homeland Security Summit invited by the governor of Hawaii. So I was asked to be the lead speaker for that function. There it's not only the U.S. Army, Air Force, and then the Marines and Navy, they take part. It's Honolulu, as you know, is the capital of the headquarters of the Pacific Fleet, which is the biggest fleet in the whole world. And so the theme was again 2611. I was asked to give a talk. And on the second day, the war game was an assault, an amphibious assault on the governor's house through the sea, something like exactly what happened in Mumbai. So this interests people with all these new features, and it will continue to be like that. So 2611 is very important. We have taken all the precautions, but there, after I finished my lecture, the host was the National Guard. As you know, National Guard in the US are under the federal control, but for the normal work, they are put under the governor. And governor uses the National Guard. And in fact, the National Guard General is the military secretary of the governor. So there is a General Lee. He asked me this question, Mr. Balchandran, why didn't Mumbai police switch off the power in both hotels and use night vision equipment to deal with trace of two terrorists in Oberoi and four terrorists in Taj? I had to say that I'm sorry, Mumbai police didn't have night vision equipment. So they had to wait for the National Security Guards. But by that time it was all, the killing was over. So when we do procure, sometimes there is a habit because of our, it's not because of, I was at pains to explain to them that the police in India is a civil police. They are not military police. Ours is a civil police. So our philosophy is to cause minimum damage, minimum force. So with the effect that if they're not used force, it's not their fault. On the other hand, not one Maharashtra constable ran away from the scene, even after facing the AK-47. If you see the visuals in CST, you'll see that man shooting with 303 outmoded Second World War rifle against the fellow who was spraying bullets on them. But he didn't run away. Not one constable ran away. That is what, and I said that these young officers confronted, both in Taj and even in Oberoi, there was a sub-inspector who had only a pistol. He tried to shoot those terrorists, but he couldn't. Fortunately, he was not killed. So this is the as far as the courage is concerned, all of them were martyrs. They stood well. They did not run away. So there are various good points of policing in 2611. Yes, unfortunately, we lost. We lost a number of people. We became the laughing stock of people. As I said, Lutuwa, a friend of mine, he writes that I'm so disappointed with India. But he doesn't realize that unlike the American police, we don't, American police shoots, and then, you know, even if the other man is unarmed, he can shoot under certain circumstances. Our police, we don't. We try to have the least amount of damage. So these are the constraints under which the police in general, they work. So the public have to understand while you take an overall view. And it is in this connection that think tanks like FINS and Professor Page will be able to contribute to the public knowledge. And I congratulate him, and I thank you all for inviting me for addressing the gathering. It's been a great pleasure. I could meet some of my old friends whom I had not met because of pandemic, and I thank you wholeheartedly. Thanks a lot.
I'm pretty sure that the stats, facts, and information shared by honorable speakers have now answered to the hovering questions since the attack day. The fogs over all the myths that have been in your minds are now been cleared. Thank you, honorable speakers. And whilst I invite Dr. Page to give away the vote of thanks, I would like the following members that have made it to the program to be acknowledged. Ambassador Jean-Marc Seré Charlotte, Consul General, France, Professor Vibhas Amaute, IIM Shillong Chairman, Management Development Programs, Coast Guard IG, Shri Iqbal Singh, and Joint CP, Shri Niket Kaushik. Now, for the vote of thanks, Dr. Vijay Page.
Thank you, Mr. Sir. At the outset, sir, I'm representing the Research Foundation and the populace here. I thank the chief guest here, Shri Balachandran, for having spared his valuable time. Dr. Paleri to come all the way from Calicut to attend this program and share his thoughts on Coast Guard and the whys of Coast Guard. Dr. Swaminathan Shivanandan, sir, who has delivered more than a doctoral thesis by presenting what action the police and the state have taken, and my dear colleague Colonel Venkatraman, who went through the Pradhan Committee report and the recommendation presented here. We also have enclosed a paper, as you would have seen in the monograph from Colonel Ram Athawale, that is about chemical, biological, and radiological and nuclear threats, to bring update of the present threat scenarios that is explained in detail. The purpose here is not to raise the specter, not to remember the evils that hit us on that day, but to learn from this and to ensure that it doesn't happen again. Because only through eternal vigilance, the price of liberty, as everyone knows the saying, it is only when we take things for granted, when we feel too assured of ourselves, that the mischief of the terrorist steps in. So the purpose in taking 2611 as a subject for popular discussion and discourse was just to issue a reminder that all is not done and gone. A brilliant path has been lit by Dr. Shivanandan's statement of alert Mumbai police and the force one that he mentioned. The NSG is in town. The Coast Guard have upgraded and built up the defense infrastructure. So all along, the hardware and software exists. What is really required here is that the mainstream, and especially the youth, to be alert and to be aware that such an incident never takes place, that nobody walks through your house and then starts shooting people at will. With that end in view, the first workshop that we have held has set the path, and we will continue to remind the citizens how, by sharing the technology and bringing in voluntary institutions, because we find the city of Mumbai has got 30,000 Ganesh Utsav mandals, has got some 15,000 mandals which regularly celebrate the Dahi Handi festival. What are all these youth organizations doing? Can they ever be networked? Is there any possibility of ensuring some enthusiasm in them that in times of emergency, they are linked up with the network and the theme of Atmanirbhar becomes Atmanirbhar? But as explained by sir, there was no shortage of bravery. The police faced the worst with brave hearts. They never backed out. We have the equipment now, and once we are able to charge the youth, we will have lit a new path. To that end, the workshop, the program today, and the discussion was aimed at. I would say that the audience here must have had various issues to be discussed. If all of them cannot be addressed because of the shortage of time, please do write to us. We have given the website. We'd be very happy to receive any inputs from your end and take back with the distinguished guests here for their answers and input. Because it's never too late. We have to maintain a level of alertness, and all of us are to be involved in this. The Brahma Research Foundation henceforth will continue to raise such issues and engage intellectuals and professionals who have spent their lifetime dedicated to the altar of the nation. In their sacrifice, what can we learn and carry the message so that we have a safe and a bright future? So this is thanking everyone. We thank all the guests who came here, Shri Shailarji, who spared his time here, the senior police officers who are here, and my colleagues from the Institutes of Management who are here to share with us, Mr. Joseph, who spared his time today. All of you, we thank you from the bottom of my heart and ensure you that Brahma Research Foundation is here to receive inputs from you, to agitate them, to take them to the seniors for their inputs, and then try and work out to a bright future. To that end, to this purpose, we will dedicate ourselves. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for having come, sir.
I request everyone present here to please raise for the national anthem. And for a change, we're not going to play the record. We're going to sing along. At the count of 3, 2, 1. Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Banga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga उच्छल जलधि तरंग तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जनगण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Here we conclude with this very auspicious evening of the launch of the Brahma Research Foundation, and request everyone present here to please have a delightful snacks outside and help yourselves. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.